I call this meeting of the Northeast Independent School District to order. Let the record show that a quorum of board members is present, that this meeting has been duly called, and that notice of this meeting has been posted in accordance with the Texas Open Meetings Act, Texas Government Code Chapter 551. The board will now adjourn into executive session pursuant to the following sections of the Texas Open Meetings Act. Texas Government Code Section 551.071, private consultation with the board's attorney, 551.072, discussing purchase, exchange, lease, or value of real property, and 551.074, to discuss personnel or to hear complaints against personnel. The time is 5:32. Thank you. The board will now reconvene into open session. The time is 6:42. Welcome to everyone. We've got a full house. It's nice to see everyone this evening. On behalf of the trustees, I would like to welcome all of you to this evening's meeting of the Northeast Independent School Board. This is a business meeting of the board held in public. We appreciate your attendance and request your respectful attention. We welcome your comments during the matters from the floor section of the agenda. If you signed up to address a specific action agenda item, you will be called at that time. Finally, I would like to remind you that it is the mission of Northeast to challenge and encourage each student to achieve and demonstrate academic excellence, technical skills, and responsible citizenship. Next item.
5, invocation and pledge of allegiance. Camelot Elementary, Wilma Payne.
Members, Dr. Gotardi, executive staff, and guest, my name is Wilma Payne, and I'm the principal of Camelot Elementary School, home of the Wonderful Knights. And it is my pleasure to introduce to you two of Camelot Elementary's fabulous students and their families that are with us tonight. Delivering the thought for the evening, I have Zaria Franks. Zaria is a fifth grader at Camelot. Besides being a leader and an all-around great student at Camelot, she is also a straight-A student in the Gifted and Talented program. Zaria is a member of Camelot's Robotic Club and our Camp Summer Dreams Club. She enjoys arts and crafts and aspires to one day become a veterinarian. And joining Zaria tonight is her mother, Arlisa Hodge, and her brother, Quaylen. Delivering the U.S. and Texas pledges tonight, I have another wonderful student, Tristan Lockett, who is also in fifth grade. Now, I have to tell you a little bit about Tristan. I've gotten a chance to work with him for quite some time, and I have enjoyed seeing his transformation into a leader. Tristan is a member of our student council, the SACE Art Program. He is part of Camelot's Leadership Academy. He enjoys playing basketball with his friends, and he aspires to one day become a football player. So joining Tristan tonight is his mother, Innocencia Rodriguez, his sister, Ariana, brothers Cranston and Christopher, who is actually a fourth grader at Camelot this year. Camelot is studying the Harlem Renaissance for Black History Month, and our students are learning about the contributions of such great African Americans as Langston Hughes, Ella Fitzgerald, and Louis Armstrong, to name a few. So our thought for the evening is a poem by Latoria Faison, and it's entitled, What is Black History? And Zaria Franks will share that with us.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Zaria Franks, and today I'll be reading a poem entitled, What is Black History? By Latoria Faison. What is Black History? It is the dirt roads our forefathers trod, memories of their lives branded in our hearts. It's a word, a place, a state of mind. Black history is a peek into our ancestors' time. It's a piece of fabric our grandmothers wore, an old rope our grandfathers lived to deplore. It's a slave ship and middle passage overseas. Black history is cotton fields and tobacco leaves. It's a plantation overseer and backdoor crumbs, weeping and wailing, a beating of drums. It is a troubling truth, an unapologetic past. Black history is an entire race struggling to last. It is a Mississippi burning in a Tennessee town, an evil that lingers to bring black people down. It is a book or movie of strength, courage, and will. Black history is the fate of young Emmett Till. It is Little Ruby Bridges, the exquisite Ruby Dee, Carter G. Woodson, and Coretta Scott King. A Mahalia Jackson song, a Michael Jackson routine. Black history is the phrase, let freedom ring. It is Sheeny University, the Tuskegee Airmen, the NAACP, the Black Holocaust Museum. It is Navy Master Diver named Carl Brashear. Black history is our legacy of triumph without fear. It is General Colin Powell of Vaudeville Drama, Zora Neale Hurston, and President Barack Obama. It is every single experience in our history. Black history is the story of you and me.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Tristan Lockett, and I'll be saying the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, two indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to the Texas, one state, under God, and indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
To Zaria and to Tristan, you did just a fabulous job, and you both look fantastic. And I'm glad you came with your principal. She's pretty. What do you think? Mr. White is here to honor you with certificates, and we are so appreciative for your attendance and, more importantly, for you being part of our schools. And congratulations to the families. We're glad you're here as well. You're welcome to stay. You're welcome to leave, whatever you prefer. Thank you for coming, Wilma. Next item.
6, matters from executive session. A, personnel, including but not limited to administrative appointments, pursuant to Government Code Section 551.074. 1, possible action regarding routine personnel, including but not limited to administrative appointments.
Do I have a motion to approve the hiring of new personnel as presented in executive session? So moved. Thank you, Mrs. Perkins. Second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. White. There could be no discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. The motion carries. Next item.
2, possible action regarding proposed recommendation for termination of Chapter 21 term contract employee.
Do I have a motion to approve the proposed termination of the identified employee Chapter 21 term contract discussed in executive session and notify the employee of the proposed action to include the grounds for the action?
So moved.
Thank you, Mrs. Perkins. Do you have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mrs. Wolf. There can be no discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. The motion carries. Next item.
3, possible action regarding proposed recommendation for termination of Chapter 21 probationary contract employee.
And we have no action.
4, introductions.
Dr. Gotardi.
Thank you, Madam President, board members, ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure this evening to introduce 2 new people to our school district this afternoon. First and foremost, we have a brand new assistant principal of MacArthur High School, Miss Ann Cook. There she is. and joined the Northeast family in 2009. Prior to being named assistant principal at MacArthur High School, she was an assistant principal at Eisenhower Middle School. Ms. Cook received her bachelor's degree in social studies in 1988 from Southeast Missouri State University and also earned her master's degree in education in 2009 from Trinity University. Ms. Cook has over 26 years in education. Congratulations, Ann. We have a new head coach, athletic coordinator at Churchill High School, Mr. Ronald Harris. Coach Harris joined the Northeast family in 2012. Prior to being named the head coach, athletic coordinator, he was the PALS Achieve teacher at Churchill High School. Mr. Harris has been Churchill's first assistant defensive coordinator for the past 3 years. Prior to coming to Churchill, he has coached and taught at Alamo Heights, University of Houston, and Texas Tech University. Mr. Harris received his bachelor's degree in political science and speech in 1980 from California Lutheran University. Mr. Harris has over 33 years in education. Congratulations, Coach, and welcome. Madam President, that concludes all of our introductions.
Thank you, Dr. Gotardi, and to Ms. Cook, all the best, and we love MacArthur High School, and I know you'll make yourself proud, and when you do that, you make us very proud. And to Mr. Harris, again, congratulations to you. I don't know if you're aware, but you have a really strong community out there. Yes. And they go to all the football games, and I am a former Churchill football mom, so I'll be following you. Charger football. So congratulations, and you have so many young men that you will be advocating for and mentoring, and what you do is so, so very important because those young men become our leaders. We're counting on you. We know you'll do well. Next item.
B, possible action on the purchase, exchange, lease, or value of real property pursuant to Government Code Section 551.072.
No action.
C, possible action regarding consultation with Board's attorney pursuant to Government Code Section 551.071. 1, possible and pending litigation.
No action.
7, comments from Board members. A, SA to DC.
And that is me, but before I do that, I would like to take a moment of personal privilege, and I want any of you to chime in. Mrs. Brooks, one of our community members and advocates, provided just a beautiful, beautiful dinner for us, and we are so appreciative. It was fabulous, and we have a little thank you note that Mrs. Huey put together, so I'd like to, would you want to present it to her, please? Thank you so much, and we just appreciate your involvement in our schools. And it's really, I think this is the first time in my 6 years that a community member has brought dinner to us. So it was really heartfelt.
Thank you so much.
And you keep coming back and keep being involved. Secondly, I had asked to be on the agenda regarding a trip that I took to Washington, D.C., and interestingly enough, I had one wish, and that was to go see, I read a beautiful book written about some abolitionists from South Carolina. I wanted to see the quilt in the American History Museum, and my daughter lives there, so she said, I will take you, and I never got there. So next time, that's my plan, and I'm really curious to see if it moves to the new museum that's really coming along beautifully. But my reason for going, first of all, thank you to all the board members, because thanks to you, I was there representing all of you and our school district. And I went to two back-to-back conferences. The first one is a National School Board Association conference in which school board members from all over the country attend to advocate for public schools. It's basically a 3-day event in which we spent 2 days in conferences and we listened to speakers. Gwen Ifill was the speaker of PBS. She was so unbelievable. She was the main speaker. And we also had Mary Matlin and James Carville. They were hysterical. They got themselves into some trouble, but the Louisiana contingent took care of them. And I was proud of the group when they called them on their facts regarding public schools. So that was interesting. And the second day, we basically talked about priorities for public schools. And I guess what made me most proud was that everybody there, there were probably 1,000 of us, such strong, strong committed people to public education, each and every one of them. So they prepared us to go to the Hill to meet with our congressmen, senators, their staffs, that sort of thing. So the next day, on Tuesday, we were there all day, and we met with Congressman Hurd. He was very gracious to meet with us. We met with Lamar Smith's staff assistant. However, she's been there for a while, and she's an education specialist. That was good. We had the opportunity to either take a picture with Senator Ted Cruz or meet with Senator Conley, Senator Cornyn's staff member. She's a PhD, and she specializes in educational priorities. Well, I'm happy to say that I chose to meet with that person, not with Senator Cruz. And she was excellent, and she wanted to know what we had to say. I think the biggest issue is coming to a consensus, because we all have different ideas, even in the public school realm. We did that. We met with Congressman Castro. He was in a Foreign Services committee meeting, but he came out, he met with us, and he was with Alicia Thomas's son, who is his legislative director. That was really, really neat to see. So I was proud of that. After that, we met with, there was another one. I can't remember. However, we also went on to meet with a lot of the, I met him, but he went to high school with my sister, but we didn't talk about that. I didn't meet with him formally. I can't recall. But from that point, we went to the Department of Education meeting, and I was thrilled to be accompanied by our Director for Governmental Affairs, Deborah Caldwell, and she was so fantastic. So she was just such a perfect face for our school district. She's smart. She knew what she was talking about. She got me out of a few binds. So I really appreciated her expertise. They listened. She was the only representative. She's standing right over there. So wave, Deborah. For K-12. That was with the chamber. So the chamber had an education committee in which there were maybe 40 of us? 17, and everyone had their needs, and it was primarily higher ed, but we got our voices heard, especially Deborah, so I was very, very pleased with that. The following day, we spent back-to-back meetings with all the departments, Department of Labor, Department of Commerce, Department of Education, House Committee Education meetings, Senate Ed Committee. We were busy. So I hope that they heard what we had to say. Again, we were the only two from K-12 there. It's a lot of political theater, but I think it's important that they know who we are, and they basically said, if there's something we would like to come back to, we've got names, we've got emails, and we were proud to represent 68,000 students, and I would say that, and then she would say, eighth largest school district in the state. So it was it's interesting, a lot happening, and they're in session, so everybody was there. And there were a lot of public school proponents, so it was a good meeting. So thank you to Dr. Gotardi and all of you for allowing me to go.
Well,
I appreciate it.
You taking time off from your real job to do that.
I did.
Well. Absolutely.
Yes. I did. I took my vacation days, so it was fine. And I got to see two of my children. And you know the other thing I forgot? There were 3 or 4 kids I met. Will Hurd just hired someone who's a graduate student, went to Churchill. My daughter works there. She went to Churchill. There was another someone else from one of our schools, so it's kind of neat to see our students on the Hill working.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
Well, we appreciate you going.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. It was a privilege. The other thing I love, it's democracy in action. I mean, you've got to fight and you've got to speak up, but it is democracy. Now, wouldn't you agree, Deborah? Lots of people up there.
And by the way, Deborah keeps me out of a lot of trouble, too.
Oh, my gosh. I would say something, and then she'd have to clarify what I was saying. You know, I'm saying more money. And she's like, well, we want your money. Anyhow, so thank you very much.
Great job.
Oh, it was interesting. Next item.
8, recognitions. A, Madison Student Act of Kindness.
Dr. Gotardi.
Where's Matt Silva? Matt, come on up here.
Thank you.
Matt Silva is a student wrestler at Madison High School. And a few weeks ago, Matt was wrestling in a district wrestling tournament here in the Northeast School District, and he was wrestling against Earl Johnson. Where's Earl? Earl, why don't you stand up and let everybody recognize you, Earl? If I give Earl a round of applause. Tournament, Matt was successful in winning that particular wrestling match against Earl, but at the end of that wrestling match, Matt gave his trophy, gave his medal to Earl. And I don't know how many of y'all saw that in the news, but this particular news story was picked up throughout the city, throughout the state, and actually national news picked up the fact that Matt, even though he had won this particular wrestling match with Earl, at the end of the wrestling match, he gave his award to Earl, who is a MacArthur student. And I think at MacArthur, Earl, Mr. Martinez and his staff periodically gives out Holy Cow awards. And Matt Silva, who is a Madison Maverick, actually got a Holy Cow award. So, we have a couple of things that we want to share with Matt Silva tonight. First and foremost is a plaque with his medal on it. And it reads, February 9, 2015, Matt Silva, character is doing the right thing when no one is watching.
Why don't you get them both together? Get the other student.
Yeah, where's the other student?
Get a picture with both of them.
Oh, thank you. That was wonderful.
Someone pass the tissues.
And congratulations to both students. Mrs. Huey, you ready for the next item?
9, presentations. A, performance by Windcrest Elementary Steppers.
Dr. Newman.
Madam President, members of the board, Dr. Gotardi, executive staff and guests, I would like to call the principal of Windcrest Elementary, Jennifer Barton, to the podium to address this item.
Good evening, Madam President, school board, Dr. Gotardi, and our executive staff, plus our Windcrest families. We have a lot of them come out tonight, which is this a new experience, obviously, for an elementary school, and so this is very new, and then all of our guests. We are so privileged to be here tonight. Since it is Black History Month, I want to give you a little bit of background on the STEP, the meaning of STEP and why we do it, and then I will give you a little bit of background on our STEP team, and then they are ready to perform. The stepping tradition in the United States grew out of a song and dance rituals practiced by historically African-American fraternities and sororities beginning in the early 1900s. Stepping is based on a long and rich tradition in African-based communities that use movement, words, and sounds to communicate allegiance to a group. It draws movements from African foot dances such as gumboot, originally conceived by miners in South Africa as an alternative to drumming. The Windcrest Star Steppers were established over 10 years ago, and we are the only Star Stepper team here in Northeast. And they were established at our school by a couple of our teachers, Ms. Pickett being one of those, and the team continues to be a tradition on campus today. At Windcrest, the goal and purpose of our team is to integrate the energy and appeal of stepping with lyrics that represent who we are and what we believe in today. Steppers use stepping as a tool to practice life skills such as teamwork, discipline, commitment, and perseverance. Our team dedicates much time and effort to practices and performances throughout the year. Tonight, the Windcrest Star Steppers are proud to perform this exciting form of art to honor the African-based tradition of step dancing. Please welcome the Windcrest Star Steppers.
I am a mountain.
Yes. Ms. Barton, thank you so much for bringing your precious students to see us and perform. They were great. Adorable. I understand.
So cute.
Ms. Barton, who are your associates here that are helping?
This is Ms. Crystal Chavez. She's my science coach.
Ms. Yay.
She's very ill. She cannot be here.
Oh.
Crystal's been there. And then we have Ms. Heather Ann Hatcher, who is a teacher, as well as Ms. Andrew.
I think they're trying to get their pictures.
Well, that's great. Thank you so much for doing that.
Well, what about? Thank you, kids. You did such a great job. Oh, they're so cute. Mrs. Huey, next item.
B, Citizens Bond Advisory Committee, annual report to the Board of Trustees.
And this is Mr. Clary.
Madam President, members of the board, Dr. Gotardi, and guests, it is with pleasure tonight I invite the chairman of the Citizens Bond Advisory Committee, Mr. Fred Morrison, to the podium. Mr. Morrison is here tonight to deliver the annual CBAC report to the Board of Trustees. Mr. Morrison.
That's a tough act to follow, by the way. Diana Schumacher recommended that I do a little dance routine first. I'm not going to do that.
Go, Fred.
I'm not a dancer. Good evening, President Bresnahan, board members, Dr. Gotardi, members of the executive staff, and members of the audience. I'm Fred Morrison, chairman of the Citizen Bonds Advisory Committee. I am here to present our 11th annual report to the board on the status of the district's bond programs covering calendar year 2014. As you know, the CBAC was first appointed in late 2003 to monitor the 2003 bond program. When Northeast residents passed the 2007 and 2011 bond programs, the CBAC's mission grew to include those bond projects. Our mission remains essentially the same since we first begun, and that is to help ensure the scope, cost, and timely delivery of each construction project in the bond program. The success of the CBAC depends on its membership, and we have a group of committed and enthusiastic members to oversee our bond projects. A few of our members have been actively involved since 2003, and I want to publicly acknowledge them for their contributions to the district. Tonight, some of our CBAC members are present, and I'd like to ask them to please stand and be recognized. Thank you. Without them, the job doesn't get done.
That's right.
With respect to the 2007 bond, all construction projects are complete and in full use. The bond program provided for 4 new elementary schools, 4 elementary school classroom additions, 15 elementary school metal gym replacements, a combination of 3 middle school and 5 high school athletic and fine arts additions renovations, a new agri-science magnetic sorry about that. Yeah, magnet program. I'm going to make it magnetic now. Facility with four
that's
main project group. Centers. I'm sorry?
That's the STEM group, but that's all right.
There you go.
It's good.
To house student livestock projects, the installation of HVAC air conditioning systems at all district athletic and PE facilities, HVAC upgrades at 15 elementary school kitchen facilities, construction of the Heroes Stadium Athletic Complex, the purchase of 130 new buses, the acquisition and renovation of the Transportation North Bus Complex, roof replacements at 12 district facilities, major upgrades to the district technology backbone infrastructure system, major acquisitions of various technology equipment packages to improve campus and classroom technology systems district-wide, and campus library collection improvements, both hard copied and digital. Overall, the 2007 bond program added a host of new educational facilities and technology system upgrades that expanded the district facility inventory to approximately 10 million square feet under roof. It's incredible.
Yeah, it is.
With respect to the 2011 bond program, the CBAC's priority focus this past year has been on monitoring the successful completion of bidding, contract award, and construction start for all projects, including the $399 million bond package. I'm pleased to report that we are 100% bid out for all of the 2011 bond program projects, that all construction projects are either underway or completed, and that currently the bond program global contingency fund balance stands at $750,000. The 2011 bond program remains on schedule, on scope, and on budget as we complete year three of a five-year program implementation schedule. I will share with you information on the 2011 bond program in two parts. First, a quick review of the major projects we completed this past calendar year, and then a look at the projects that were either underway or awarded during the past calendar year. Let me start by addressing our flagship project within the 2011 bond program, David Lee Tex Hill Middle School. This beautiful campus opened this past August on time and $2.75 million under budget. The formal dedication of this impressive facility was held this past November 11th, Veterans Day, a fitting tribute to the military veteran for whom the school is named. Our compliments to Jarvis General Contractors for the completion of the construction on schedule and Pfluger Architects for a truly outstanding design concept that will serve this district well for many years. We completed the new JROTC facility at Lee High School in December of 2014. This facility includes 16-lane rifle range for the use as a destination shooting range facility to host multi-team competitions. The JROTC cater and students are putting the final touches on the transition and occupancy phase for this new district facility this month. Jarvis General Contractors did another outstanding job with the construction of this facility, as well as Pfluger Architects for development of an excellent design concept. We also wrapped up a project that involved construction on multiple campuses, the district-wide chalkboard replacement project. As I reported to you last year, the chalkboard replacement project included a replacement of more than 2,000 chalkboards scattered across the district with new dry erase magnetic whiteboards. The project consisted of 41 schools, including 5 high schools, 8 middle schools, 28 elementary schools. Alpha Building Corporation successfully completed phase 1 work at 19 schools during the summer of 2013. Phase 2 work, consisting of the remaining 22 schools, was successfully completed this past summer. Next, I will quickly summarize the major 2011 bond projects that are currently underway, including those campuses where additional phases or bid packages were awarded during this past year. I will address the high school projects first, followed by the middle school projects, and then those at our elementary schools. Churchill High School, designed by RVK Architects and construction by Guido Brothers Construction, work began on the new campus JROTC facility in December 2013 and will be completed in March 2015, with move-in projected in early April 2015. Follow-on demolition work and construction of 2 new tennis courts will be completed between April and June 2015. Overall, the Churchill High School bond construction project is 76% complete. Lee High School, designed by Pfluger Architects and construction by Jarris General Contractors. As previously mentioned, Lee High School now has the newest JROTC facility in the district, with campus occupancy of the facility underway. Work began in May 2014 on the new science and classroom addition, the new athletic addition with rooftop tennis courts, and central plant expansion, with work on these areas to be completed in the mid-2016 timeframe. Overall, these construction efforts are 20% complete. Later this year, work will commence on the Fine Arts Auditorium lobby addition and campus entrance walkway upgrades, with work to be completed by the mid-2016 timeframe. MacArthur and Johnson High Schools, designed by Garza Bombegger and Associates and construction by Guido Brothers Construction. The Johnson High School restroom concession stand facility began construction in July 2014 and is on schedule for completion in early March 2015. This project is about 53% complete. Work began on the MacArthur High School new JROTC facility in August 2014, with completion scheduled for October 2015. The construction of the MacArthur High School new science and classroom addition began in November 2014, with completion planned for December 2016. The new athletic addition at MacArthur High School will begin construction in December this year, with completion planned for November 2016. Overall, the MacArthur High School bond construction project is 7% complete. Reagan High School, designed by RVK Architects and construction by Jarris General Contractors. Phase one, which included the new soccer field and parking lot area, was completed in July of 2014 and has been in use by the campus since this past August. Phase two, which includes construction of the new science and classroom addition, athletic addition, and restroom concession stand facilities, on schedule for completion and occupancy this coming August 2015. Phase three, which includes the interior renovation of the existing athletic facility area, is scheduled to begin construction in August 2015, following occupancy of the new athletic addition this summer. Renovation work will conclude in July 2016 as planned. Phase four, which includes upgrades to the competition football field, is scheduled to begin construction December 2015 and completed by July 2016. Overall, the Reagan High School bond construction project is 51% complete. Middle schools, four projects. Eisenhower Middle School, designed by Mormon Mock Architecture and Construction by Jarris General Contractors. Bid package one, which included site work and utilities installation, was completed between May and October 2014. Bid package two, which includes a new classroom and athletic additions, started in September 2014, is in scheduled for completion in February 2016. Overall, the Eisenhower Middle School bond construction project is 25% complete. Garner Middle School, designed by Garza Bombegger and Associates and construction by Bartlett Koch General Contractors. Bid package one, which included site infrastructure, site utilities, and drainage channel improvements, was completed in June 2014. Bid package two, which includes new classroom addition, new central energy plant, and campus renovations, began work in April 2014 and is on schedule for completion in January 2016. Overall, the Garner Middle School bond construction project is 37% complete. Nimitz Middle School, designed by O'Neill Conrad Oplett Architects and construction by Jarris General Contractors. Bid package one, which included campus drainage improvements, was completed in July 2014. Bid package two, phase one, which includes the new athletic and orchestra facilities, began construction in February 2014 and is completion scheduled for next month, February 2015. This phase of a very complex project is 92% complete. Bid package two, phase two, which includes the new classroom, library, administration, counseling, and clinic addition, will begin construction in March of this year and can be completed by mid-2016. Overall, the Nimitz Middle School bond construction project is 40% complete. White Middle School, designed by Pfluger Architects and construction by Bartlett Koch General Contractors. Work began on this new athletic addition in June 2014, with completion scheduled for November 2015. Overall, the White Middle School bond construction project is 31% complete. We're getting close, okay? A lot of work going on here. Camelot Elementary School, designed by O'Connell Robertson Architects and construction by Bartlett Koch General Contractors. Work began on the new classroom, library, administrative counseling, and clinic addition in February 2014, and is scheduled for completion in May 2015. Follow-on interior campus renovations and project site work will be accomplished between June and September 2015. Overall, the Camelot Elementary School bond construction project is 60% complete. Coker Elementary School, designed by De Munbrun Scarnato Associates and construction by Bartlett Cock General Contractors. Work began on the new classroom, library, administration, counseling, and clinic addition in May 2014 and is scheduled for completion in July 2015. Follow-on interior campus renovations and project site work will be completed by December 2015. Overall, the Coker Elementary School bond construction project is 33% complete. Windcrest Elementary School, designed by Alamo Architects and construction by Jarris General Contractors. Bid package one, which includes the classroom and library addition, began work in December 2013 and is scheduled for completion in April 2015. Follow-on interior campus renovations will occur between April and September 2015. Overall, the Windcrest Elementary School construction project is 50% complete. To recap, the district completed the remaining 13 of 24 planned construction bids for the 2011 bond program in 2014. This represented $143 million, or 52% of the bond construction value. The majority of these projects bid below the board-approved construction budget, achieving program savings for the 2011 bond program. In addition to facility, design, and construction, which represents $303 million, of the 2011 bond program budget and now stands at an overall 50% construction completion. Other important bond initiatives, including district-wide technology improvements and enhancements, and library resources, $64 million, and transportation bus purchases, $9.2 million. Significant progress was made throughout 2014 in library resource procurements, campus infrastructure network technology upgrades, and procurement of designated instructional technology hardware and software systems. The total procurement in the technology and library resources area for the 2011 bond program now stands at 77% complete. Additionally, the final round of bus purchases was accomplished in 2014, which resulted in the total 2011 bond program bus acquisition of 100 new buses for the district's transportation department. All these programs remain on schedule to complete their respective objectives within the allocated budgets. Wow. The 2011 bond program remains in excellent shape, projecting a current bond program global contingency fund balance of $750,000. The CBAC will continue to aggressively exercise its oversight role to ensure caution when deciding to recommend expanding the scope or upgrading any remaining 2011 bond projects until all projects are successfully completed. On behalf of the entire committee, I wish to thank Garrett Sullivan, the entire Construction Management and Engineering Department, and the Community Relations staff for all the extra effort provided to support our monthly and our quarterly CBAC meetings. Thank you for your time this evening. This concludes the annual CBAC report for the calendar year 2014.
Mr. Morrison, thank you so much. How long have you served on this committee? It's been a few years. Since 10. Do we have any questions or comments for Mr. Morrison?
Great job.
Thank you. Well, and I think the fact that you're at Citizens representing our school district, a complete separate entity, is such a checks and balance for all of us. It's what you do is really important, as well as your members. Thank you.
Thank you.
And you can keep aggressively overseeing. I like that.
Thank y'all for being here.
Yeah, we appreciate it. Thank you. Next item.
C, public hearing for the 2013-2014 Texas Academic Performance Report.
I believe this is Mr. Kurth.
Thank you. Madam President and members of the board, Dr. Gotardi, executive staff, and guest. Today we're here to talk about the Texas Academic Performance Report, otherwise known as the TAPR. It is required by TEA that we come to you every year and really give you some basic information. And one of the requirements is that we have to disclose this, or to have this hearing, no later than 90 days after the report is received, which was received in November. And it has to be published within 2 weeks after tonight's hearing. The report itself includes PEAM's financial standards report, and that financial information was already given to you by Brian Moy in November as part of the CAFR report. Campus performance objectives is done every year by Terry Chidgey through the district improvement plan. And tonight we're going to talk about the report of violent criminal incidents, as well as information from the Texas Higher Education Coordinating Board. Of course, after tonight, we will publish this online. We have a spot actually reserved toward the bottom here that will post tonight's presentation. And with me today is our Senior Director of Research and Planning, Mr. Jeff Kurth, and he's going to go over the presentation.
Okay, thank you, Mike. All right, so we're going to first start out with the Texas Academic Performance Report. Just to let you know, this report is close to 20 pages long. There's up to 35 indicators, and so I've identified those on this slide here. So they start with star percent of phase-in satisfactory standard all the way down to just program information. And Mike, next. We're going to focus on some of the indicators that are found within our accountability system. And so you can see here, for our accountability system, as you remember, we have indices 1 through 4, distinction designations, and system safeguards. And so as we go through these different indicators, just to let you know that how they relate to the accountability system. In the past, if you remember the old AEIS report, the indicators in that report were not aligned with the accountability system back then. So they really have, the state of Texas really has done a great job of to align the indicators that are found in this report with the actual accountability system. And I'm going to kind of point that out as we go today. To start out with, the accountability, the TAPR report provides us with the labels. And for Northeast Independent School District, the label that we were given is met standard for 2014. For campuses, we have 67 campuses. 66 were given the rating of met standard. We had one elementary campus that was improvement required. The TAPR report also provides for us the campus distinction designations for all different levels, for all campuses at the high schools, middle schools, and elementary schools. There are actually 7 different indicators that are found or, that are found within the distinction designation. Under academic achievement, you have 4 subjects, which are reading, math, science, and social studies. We have a 5th indicator for student progress. That is aligned with the index 2. We have closing performance gaps, which is aligned with index 3. And then finally, the post-secondary readiness that uses indicators that are found within index 4. And just to let you know how well we did, I think we did really, really well. For the state, 48% of the campuses across the state received at least one designation. In our district, we had 70% of our campuses that received at least one designation. We had a number of campuses that received all the possible designations they could have received, and many campuses that received multiple 2, 3, 4, and 5 designations. So how do you receive a distinction designation? There's certain criteria, and that criteria is you relate that to the comparable campus group. So every campus in the state of Texas has 40 campuses that are related to them based on campus characteristics. If you rank in the top quartile in a specific indicator, you're identified as meeting that indicator. So for example, if you look at the first column there, where it says high for reading ELA, there are actually 6 indicators that could be used at the high school level, you have to receive up to 33%. So in this case, since there are six indicators, you have to get two out of those six indicators in the first quartile to be able to receive that distinction designation. In middle schools and elementary schools, you have to receive 50% of the indicators meeting that distinction of being in the first quartile. So here, for the reading ELA, middle and elementary have four possible indicators, so they'll have to receive two out of four indicators in the first quartile to be able to receive the distinction designation in that area. Okay, so starting with this graph, you're going to see as you look, we're going to do comparisons with the state in our district. So our state will always be on the left-hand side. As you can see, that will be in that olive green color. And then the district rates will be found on the right-hand side, which is that orangish color, orangish-brown color that you see. So to start out with the ethnic distribution, you can see us compared to the state, and our highest percent for an ethnic group, a race group, as you can see, is the Hispanic group. Below there, you can see economically disadvantaged and ELL. So right now, our economically disadvantaged numbers are at 46.5%. Our English language learners are at 9.6%. I'll let you know for this school year, 14-15 school year, that has already grown to 10.4%, and it continues to grow daily, of course. Continuing the student information, these are our programs and our percentages by program. So you can see the numbers compared to the state for bilingual ESL, our career and technical programs, our gifted and talented, and our special education. This is our first performance indicator that we're going to look at, and this is based on the phase-in one satisfactory standard. And you can see this is for reading, and this goes from grade 3 all the way over to English 1 and English 2. As you can see, in our upper grade levels, we perform really well as compared to the state. English 1 and English 2, I would say we knocked the socks off of the state. We've done really, really well. This was the first year, remember, that we actually combined the reading and the writing test for EOCs. So although it says English 1 reading 1 and English 2 reading 2, that's really a combination reading and writing test. And so I think we did really well at the high school levels and very well at some of the other grade levels too. Math, you see here from grade 3 all the way to Algebra 1. We have grades 3 and 4, we're about at the state level, and we move over to the Algebra 1 where we're 9 percentage points above the state for that. You also notice that 8th grade, that we're just 1 percentage point above, but remember, at 8th grade, we have over 50% of our students that actually take Algebra 1 at 8th grade level. So these are the students that are taking regular 8th grade math and their performance as compared to the state. Writing. So we have 4th and 7th. You'll see that there's no EOC here. And remember I told you that that's actually combined in the English 1 and English 2 tests now. So we outperformed at 4th and 7th grade by 3 to 5 percentage points from the state. Social studies and U.S. history. So we have our 8th grade social studies and our U.S. history scores. And we did very well at those levels. As you can see, U.S. history is very high, in the high 90s. Science and biology, so grades 5, 8, science, and our biology EOC course. You can see how we performed, and once again, we've outperformed the state in those areas. This is the combined scores. So that first, all subjects, that's all the subjects, all grade levels, all combined in one, so we had a score of an 82. Just a reminder, that 82, that is actually index one that you're looking at there. So this is what I was speaking of, that where it's actually now aligned when you look at the TAP-R report, that it's aligned with our accountability system. Okay? This is the post-secondary readiness standard. And this is identified by the state as those students that are sufficiently prepared for post-secondary readiness. You see that the scores are significantly lower, the percent of students meeting that standard are significantly lower. So you can see for two or more subjects, and that's where students, all students at all grade levels take at least two tests and maybe three tests. So that's the percentage of students that met this standard at both, at least two subject areas. So that's 50% for us for the district and 41% for the state. Now, that's found in Index 4. And just to let you know why that percentage is so low, I want to give you an example of the third grade math. And if you take a look at third grade math, you see on the first column going down where it starts with 27, that's the number of questions you need to get right to meet the phase-in one standard. The recommended standard, which this post-secondary readiness standard is based on, you have to actually get 38 questions right. That's a difference of 11 questions to be able to meet, to meet this standard. And that's why you see those percentages are getting so low. Now, just to let you know, if you're still here in the year 21-22, that will be the standard. That's the standard that the commissioner has set for accountability. So we won't be in phase in one. We will actually be at this recommended standard. So we have till 21-22 to be able to move that percentage up. And that's what we're working at, and all districts in the state are working towards. Okay, so advanced standard. So this is... I would say it's similar to the old commended tax standard, except for it's a little more rigorous. And you can see the percentages there for all subjects, although we're 5 percentage points above the state, it's at 20%. And if Mike could go to the next slide, just to let you know, and this is part of the Index 3, is one of the indicators for Index 3. The next one. And just to let you realize, that same test, the grade 3 math, rather than 11 questions, now you have to get 42 questions right, which is 15 more questions correct than where we are right now with our passing standard. And that's the reason why you see such a lower percentage of students meeting that standard. Index two, of course, is the progress measure. So this is, as you remember, you're looking at students who have a current score and they actually took the test, a prior year STAR test. They look at the differences between scale scores and look to see how if they are greater than or equal to an expected gain. And from that, you can either be identified as meeting progress or exceeding progress. So this, what we're looking at here is either met or exceeded progress. For reading and math, we're both at 63% as relates to the for the state at 61 and 60%, respectively. Progress for prior year STAR failures. This identifies current fourth through eighth graders, that actually failed the test last year. So looking at those students that failed last year, and what percentage of those failures from the prior year actually passed this current year? And you can see for us, for reading and math, that 52% of those kids from the prior year that had failed actually passed the test. And I think that shows the work that we've been doing in our district in trying to make those huge improvements. Student Success Initiative, as you remember, that's grades 5 and 8 for math and reading. This is where we were after the first administration for SSI, or Student Success Initiative. After the second administration, we increased those scores to the ones where you see in the olive green, or that green color. So for grade 5 reading, we went from 83 to 90% after the second administration. For math, 84 to 91. Eighth grade reading, 88 to 93. And for math for grade 8, we went from 81 to 88%. Attendance and dropout rates, another indicator that's found in our TAPR report. We can see 3 years worth of attendance rates for us for the 2012-13 school year all the way back to the 2010-11 school year. And in the bottom right-hand corners are our dropout rates. And you can see that we're lower than the state for those, which is good, because it's, we're looking at those kids that that had dropped out for grades 7, 8, or for grades 9 through 12. Graduation rates, in the upper left-hand corner is the state-defined graduation rate for the four-year longitudinal graduation rate. And you can see for our class of 2013, we were at 89%. And then in the bottom right-hand corner is the federal graduation rates. You see it's a little bit lower, and that's because they include two leaver codes that are not included for the state. And those are kids that, I think a leaver code 88 is for students who are, getting out what they are, so I have it here. You think I'd know this. I know that 89 is the federal, students that are adults are in the federal penitentiary. And I think, I know 88 is now a state that they are, they've been a court ordered GED. And so those are the two groups. So in the state, we exclude those. In the federal, we're not allowed to exclude them. Okay? Recommended and distinguished graduates for the class of 2013, which I think is such as the longitudinal rate, those are the cohort of 2009-2010. We had for the number of graduates that graduated with a recommended or distinguished plan, it was at 84.6% as compared to the state, it was at 83.5%. Advanced course and dual enrollment completion. For 2012-13, you can see that 36.7% of our students took a course in advanced course for or a dual enrollment course that was found for the high school credit and also for college credit. College-ready graduates. This is an indicator that identifies students that are what they call college-ready. And there's a number of ways in which you can define that. These students were the 2013, I think the 2013 graduates that took the tax test in 2011, which was the last year that we took tax. So this is the last time we'll see this indicator as defined by tax. So they're still working on what is that going to look like with STAR, what will be the actual standard for that. But for those kids, if they had an exit level tax score of 2200 or greater, or in a 3 or higher on the essay for either one of the tests, or they could also have met the standard if they took the SAT test and got a total of a 1070, or they took the ACT test with a composite of a 23. They were identified in the numerator for this. So you can see for math, I mean ELA was 71%, math 78%, combined it was 63% of our graduates were identified as being college ready. AP, I think you've heard a lot about our AP, what we've been doing in this area. Once again, we have been we've been identified on the honor roll by the AP or the College Board. We had 34.4% tested this year or the year which was identified here for 2013. The prior year was a percentage point lower. So we have actually increased the number of kids that are taking AP courses, and we've also increased the actual number percentage that meet the criteria, and that's gone up from about a percentage and a half to 57.6%. At the same time, we have provided a more diverse group has been part of this group. So we're really excited that more and more types of students are actually taking advantage of AP courses and. Hopefully we'll continue in this, moving in this direction. SAT. SAT, ACT results, looking at the class of 12-13, 72.3% of our students took SAT test or an ACT test, and 32% of those students met the criteria, which was 1110. So if they were able to meet that criteria. So that was really good. Average SAT scores, you can see the comparisons for class of 2013 and 2012 for the district versus the state. Okay, so I'm going pretty fast, but that's okay as we go here. So annual report on school safety. So we're going to change gears here just real quickly. And we're going to, we're required as we do this report that we report on violent and criminal incidences and what kinds of programs and curriculum that we have on, in our district to decrease the number of criminal and violent incidences. I'm going to show you a couple slides of data. You might glance at that. There's a lot of these here. The misconducts start with conduct punishable as a felony. That's that first column going down. And we have actually 3 years of data that Ann McNabb and her group has provided us. So you can see 11, 12, 12, 13, and 13, 14 for all of those possible misconduct. Just a reminder that these are incidences. These aren't numbers of kids. So there could be something that has happened where a student has been identified with more than one misconduct during one incident. So just a reminder of that. And at the bottom, you can see the total number of violent criminal incidences from 1 year to the next. So, as you know, prevention and intervention starts with well-informed students, parents, and staff. We, of course, we provide the district student parent handbook in two languages for our students and our parents. And we also review these highlights from the handbooks with students, and we reinforce the rules and expectations throughout the whole school year. So we have a variety of curriculum that are found in our district. And just to name these as we go through here, we have Amigos in Mediation, which is a peer-based mediation group or program. There's Character Counts, Self-Managers, Safe School Ambassadors, CHAMPS, and Project Wisdom. And our district works to ensure there's a consistent application of discipline management throughout the district. We also have a series of programs that are found within our district. We have the Leader in Me. We have our STAN, which is a Student Teacher Assistant Network. We have PALS, Peer Assistance Leadership and Service, Peer Mediation, Safe School Ambassadors, Second Step, a violence prevention curriculum, and Steps to Respect, which is a bullying prevention program. Finally, we're looking at the higher education data that's provided us in the TAPR report, and we also added some information as we go here. To start out with is the graduates enrolled in higher education. So these are our the 11-12 data that you see there. That's our 11-12 high school graduates that enrolled in fall of 2012 and went to college the 2012-13 school year. And so you could see the number of graduates that enrolled in Texas Institution of Higher Education, there's 60% of our students have done that. In the bottom right are the percentage of students that did enroll in a Texas Institute of Higher Education that did not need any kind of remediation course. So that shows that in our district that 74% of our students were able to start taking courses that were not college-level remediation courses. This is 2 years worth of data. We have our 2011-12 graduates and our 2012-13 graduates. And this shows those graduates from our high schools and where did they go the following year. And you can see the top two colleges that you see in there are San Antonio College and the University of Texas, San Antonio. And then Texas State and University of Texas are the next two that as we go there. If you look in the 2012-13 graduates, you see at the very bottom that there are around 4,600 students or graduates that we had. We actually have 2,086 students that are not identified, that we didn't find. Either they didn't go to a university the next year, or they could possibly have gone to a university outside of the state of Texas. So the Texas Higher Ed Coordinating Board does not track those students that are outside of our state. So just a reminder of that. Lastly, the 2012 Texas high school graduates, when they enrolled in 2013 in a university, for that year, what was their grade point average, or what was the percentage of students that had a grade point average of 3 or higher? And so for a four-year public university, we had 45% of our students with a GPA of 3 or higher. And for a two-year public college, it was 39% of our students. And that's all I have. So if anybody would like to contact me about this report, they're welcome to email me at jkurth@neisd.net or call our office. And just to let you know, we also have hard copy reports of this. They'll be online. They're already posted online. And if anybody needs a hard copy, they can go to the information desk across the way here, and we'll be glad to print out that for any individuals in our community.
Do we have any questions for Mr. Kurth or Mr. Latta? Thank you very much for the presentation, and it would be an excellent job of putting everything
Thank you.
Together.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I always wonder if people realize just how much work goes on. Yeah.
Next item.
D, competitive food sales and fundraisers.
Mr. Clary.
Madam President, members of the board, Dr. Gotardi and guest, our executive director for school nutrition, Ms. Sharon Glosson, is at the podium to make a short presentation at the request of the board in relation to competitive food sales and fundraisers.
Thank you.
Very short.
Okay.
Good evening. Thank you very much for this opportunity to present. Competitive food sales and fundraisers is a topic that changes as regulations change. And so what I'll be presenting tonight is the most current regulation that Northeast ISD is following. The Healthy Hunger Free Kids Act came in 2010 from the federal government, and it made a lot of changes to the school meals as well as meals that are sold outside of the cafeteria. And so the major guidelines that impacted competitive foods was the USDA Smart Snacks, and that just came about in July of this year. So this is still very new to us and new to our campuses. We were used to the Texas Public School Nutrition Policy since 2004, but because of this new federal policy, the state decided to repeal the Texas Public School Nutrition Policy so that we wouldn't be following two sets of guidelines addressing the same issues. The Smart Snacks guidelines impacts all food sold during the school day, and they have to meet those very strict nutrition criteria if they're going to be sold out of a vending machine, or if they're going to be sold by a school store, or sold by a student fundraiser, and so, or if the cafeteria is selling these items out of a snack bar. So this is new in that sodium is addressed, in that trans fat, total sugar, so it's a lot of things that before we worried about fat, calories, and certain sugars in certain items. So NEISD has decided to adopt stricter regulations than the federal rules in regards to when competitive foods can be sold during the school day. And NEISD decided to make those regulations because of our parent involvement, our community involvement, and the feedback that we got from them. And so the FFAR is actually where all of the specifics are addressed so that you can go by level and see exactly what the rules are by elementary, middle, or high school. The School Health Advisory Committee is where we got the feedback for this regulation. And the SHAC, as we call it, actually is composed of parents, community members, as well as district staff from health services, school nutrition, PE, and we meet monthly. We have a very large group, and it's very active. One of the best groups that I've seen of any of the other districts, in that we do have the 50% or more involvement of people who don't work for the district. And so that says a lot that they care about the health of our students. We have a nutrition subcommittee of the SHAC, and that's actually chaired by a parent volunteer. It's not chaired by a district staff member. So the desires are really geared towards what the parents are wanting to see. And every year we review the wellness regulation to see if it needs to be updated with new legislative updates or just updates that the community wants to see. And then, so to get into the specifics, the high schools, they cannot serve or provide access, meaning give away for free, competitive foods during meal service, meaning during breakfast or during lunch. So outside of those times, Our local regulation says that they could possibly have those sales if the school approved it. But the competitive food sold during that day, even if it's outside the meal periods, have to meet those strict nutrition criteria that I was showing you, because anything during the school day has to meet those guidelines, even if it's out of a vending machine or out of a school store. So they have to get approval of what items they plan to sell to make sure that they don't get the district into financial penalties. And less than half of their school fundraisers during a year can be food related. So we're encouraging non-food fundraisers like fun runs and selling pencils, selling school shirts, doing things to get away from food. And then no candy fundraisers at all are allowed by the school campus. Middle school, they have different guidelines in that they cannot have competitive food sales at all during school until 30 minutes after school ends. And they still have the same criteria of less than half of fundraisers can be food and then no candy. And then elementary is the same as middle school, so they're not allowed to have the competitive foods during school. Principals do have some local control in that, as I said, outside of meal periods at the high school level, they could have food sales, but because of the strict nutrition criteria and because of the less than half of the fundraisers can be food related, it's very difficult for them to approve food fundraisers and feel like they're going to meet criteria because there are so many clubs and organizations. How would they choose who to allow to sell food and who not to? And so that it is somewhat locally controlled, but it's a very difficult decision. And so in a lot of ways, because we're encouraging non-food fundraisers, the principals are also encouraging non-food fundraisers for their school clubs. And so I listed some resources. Again, our board policy, FFA, it lists what the federal guidelines are, but our administrative regulation, FFA, is really where the details are, that our local community has gotten executive staff to approve. And then squaremeals.org is our state agriculture department who provides our guidance. And then you see also the USDA, which is our federal oversight, who came out with all of the Smart Snacks guidelines. That's my presentation, to go through it very quickly. Did y'all have any questions?
Any questions?
Glad I don't have to keep up with it.
Now, thank you very much. Next item.
E, facilities planning process.
Mr. Clary.
Madam President, members of the board, Dr. Gotardi and guests, Mr. Garrett Sullivan and Ms. Deb Caldwell are making their way to the podium, and they are here to discuss the facility needs assessment and the community facility needs survey that were both recently done, as well as the planning process that will be used by Dr. Gotardi to determine whether to move forward with the plans for a future bond. So at this time, I am going to turn it over to Mr. Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Clary. Good evening, members of the board, Dr. Gotardi, executive staff, and guests. It's my pleasure tonight to offer a short presentation on transforming in the future our facilities planning process. As we briefed you in November, prior to the initiation of our district's facility needs survey, within the Transforming the Future program the district initiated last year, and we're now beginning the year two implementation plan, there is a specific objective that was developed by goal number 8 to address inequalities district-wide, and also in goal number 2 there was an objective to address technology inequalities district-wide. So this year the committee, the steering committee for the Transforming the Future, has identified the district facility needs inequities as a goal for year 2 implementation. So this is a good dovetail with the process that I'm going to brief you tonight, that it has been adopted by the strategic design team as a goal for our year two implementation. We did something that we have never done before in the time that I've been here, and I'm into my 16th year, which is we actually went out to all the various stakeholders across the district and asked them to complete a survey that we developed back last year to gather information, gather good information about the state of the district's facilities. And we did that over a month-long period between November, mid-November and mid-December. We had 97 separate participants, including principals for their campuses and then for special programs, cabinet and department heads, which are executive directors and directors, to address their specific programs that they have oversight over at the district level. After we gathered that information, after the new year, we allowed the cabinet to review the input from all the various campuses and to refine their specific data, because they have a great role to play in helping to guide us in terms of addressing which needs as the highest priority and then moving down the list to the lowest priority. We also conducted an online community survey from the latter part of January through the early part of February, which we're going to discuss in more detail in just a few minutes. And we believe that overall, all these survey results, all this information is going to help guide the district in determining whether to move forward with a future bond program, either in this year, 2015, or in a future year. So let's talk a little bit about the survey results, which is going to be something I'm going to focus on this evening. I have a little training aid here. Being a former military officer, we always love to have training aids. So in this box represents one complete set of all the input that we got from the survey that were conducted in both November, December, and then by the cabinet again in January. So I'm going to take this out and just kind of show you the great wealth of information that we've collected. I don't want to block you, ma'am, so I'm going to put this down a little bit. Now, first of all, the elementary schools, we have 46 of those, so every campus principal spent a great deal of time completing their surveys. So we have a three-volume set for the elementary schools, one for each elementary school. And these surveys could be anywhere from 10 to 20 pages, depending on how much information the campus wanted to provide in the comments section. Now, we spent a lot of time as a district staff. Dr. Gattardi was our leader in this initiative, along with Mr. Cabello, who's our director of planning and design, Mr. Gerwitz, our webmaster, and then Ms. Caldwell, who's our czar for the planning process, but she's the director of governmental programs and grant development, in terms of coming up with what questions to ask, because no survey is worth its salt unless you have good questions. So we went through three rounds of development of the survey questions because we really wanted to refine the kind of information we wanted at our disposal to develop good quality plans for addressing our facilities inequity. So we got really good feedback from the campus principals. This is the middle school results, 14 middle schools. The high school results, we had 11 input, both the eight major high schools and then all the special other high school programs. As an example, like our automotive magnet program, Mr. Bailey got to provide input because he's a standalone program at a separate facility. We then had all the various cabinet and department heads fill out their information, and they got to give us their top 40 elementary, middle school, high school, and then district-wide needs as they saw what were the greatest needs for their program areas. And then we combined all of this information, which was gathered in SurveyMonkey, which was the vehicle by which we conducted the survey, into a very condensed format, which is our executive level format. This is all great information. You can spend a lot of waking moments reading it. But it wasn't as useful as what we came up with as our last product. Yes, I saved the best for last. And Dr. Gattardi likes to call this our facility study Bible. Now, this product was developed internally by the district. We developed this in the construction management department. And what we did is we took all this information and we combined it by the age of the facility, being the oldest schools are listed first in the book. We color-coded all the Likert questions. Remember, we had up to 90 different Likert questions where we asked questions from very good to very poor, because we wanted to get a good barometer of what the quality of the facilities or the specific areas were that we were focused on. Very good was green, good was blue, fair was yellow, poor was orange, and very poor was red. So this book essentially compiles all this information, but it adds color, it adds the age of the facility, so you can easily breeze through here and you can see the older schools which are listed in the front are mainly orange, reds, and yellows with some blues and greens, and the newer schools is mainly blues and greens. Now, we expected to see this. In fact, if we hadn't seen this trend, we would have been surprised, because obviously the older schools are where they're going to have the greatest needs. And that's exactly what the information provided us. But now we have very exact and detailed information to go on in terms of our planning process. So we've got a great wealth of information that we can use as cabinet, department heads, and the steering committee in order to guide us in terms of how we approach addressing these inequalities, not only in the next bond program or in future bond programs. Now, I'm going to be followed by Mrs. Caldwell, who's going to present the online community survey results.
Thank you, Mr. Sullivan. As mentioned earlier, the online community survey ran from January 23rd to February 6th. It just closed this past Friday, so we are still analyzing those results. We're not prepared to bring that information to you this evening, but I can tell you some of our participation numbers, which I can say I am personally very pleased with the amount of folks who responded. We have more than 6,500 participants. 81 of those were folks who took our Spanish survey, and of those, the primarily were parents, followed by teachers. And as a reminder, those numbers that are indented aren't going to add up to 65-46, because a participant could choose one or more affiliations. So you could be a parent and a teacher, as an example. So that we wanted to understand whose voices we were hearing from. I can say that overall the questions were at a higher level to perceive what our community felt about how we were dealing with infrastructure and facility needs and safety enhancements across the district. It did not get into the level of detail as the principal survey, but we did ask them for some general opinions about our facilities. And together, we feel that the data that will be combined with what the principals told us will be a very important piece to understanding our facility needs across the district. So I'll turn it over to Dr. Gotardi.
Thank you, Deb, and thank you to Gary. Board members, ladies and gentlemen, I'll just have to tell you that with Deb Caldwell being our Director of Governmental Relations, Gary Sullivan, Executive Director of Construction Management, Jorge Cabello, Patty Casiano, with her help, with Ron Clary, Dan Villarreal, their leadership, I feel extremely good about the process. And I have to tell you, I'll start off with my comments by saying this, that during the school year 2014, calendar year 2014, I can't even tell you how many times, but I would say at least 30 to 50 times, people came up to me and said, Dr. Gotardi, since 1995, we've had a bond program about every 3 to 4 years. And if I do my math right, 2011 to 2015 is right there. Are we going to have another bond program? That was a question that I've received a lot. And I wanted to be prepared to answer that question. So back in October, November, we as a staff began working on the two survey monkeys that Gary and Deb reported on, because I want to be able to have very good information before we come back to you and say, yes, we need to do a bond, or no, we're not ready for a bond, or 2016, 2017. You know, I just didn't know. So I want to be prepared to have absolutely the best information I can have prior to making that recommendation to you. The next slide that's on your chart here is where we're going with our facility planning process. beginning in March, we will begin to have two different types of meetings. We will start have, well, really three kinds of meetings, because staff is going to meet, and you'll see on the next page, you'll see that in just a little bit. You'll see where executive staff and key district people will be meeting weekly. We will be having community meetings that are getting ready to go out to the community and let them know when we're going to be having those meetings and where. And then we're also going to put together a facility steering committee, something that we did a little bit of this in 2007. We had a facility steering committee, but I hold my hat on the transformation process. And if you remember what we went through the last 2 years with our strategic design process, we had thousands of people who gave us input, but it really came down to about 35 or 40 steering committee members that helped us really guide that direction for the next 5 years in the school district with transformation. So we will have a facility steering committee as well that will meet five or six times in the spring. The community meetings that we're planning on having either here or across the street are probably going to meet three or four times. And that's the calendar that we're going to lay out in front of you for the next 4 months. My plan is to present all of this data to community meetings, to go back and have steering committee meetings. And then the culmination will be that on June the 15th, that is a board meeting, and that's a time where members of the facility steering committee and myself will come to you and say, okay, we've done all this work, we've had all these meetings, this is our plan, this is our recommendation to you about when we need to go out to our voters for another bond election. Bond elections are always very nerve-wracking for all of us, but I wanted to be sure that when we make a recommendation to the school board or when we go out to our voters, I want to have absolutely the best information available. On February the 9th, which is a great day, February 9th, great day, I feel very good about the process. I really do. The kind of information that Gary has out there on the bar here, the kind of information that we will get from, my goodness, 6,500 district, either parents, taxpayers, teachers, students filled out, that's just fantastic information. So I think we're off to a great start. I feel very good about the calendar over the next March, April, and May, and into June. One of the things that I'm going to make sure that you're on board with is that of the 40-member steering committee, I would say that 39 of those people are going to be district residents. They're not necessarily district staff at all. I say the one person because I plan on being on the steering committee, but the other 39 people are going to be district constituents. What I would like to do is I would like to appoint one of your three appointees that you put on the CBAC. I would like for one of those three to serve on the facility steering committee as well. So we will be in conversation about that particular appointee. Deb and I met for some time today to try to solidify that steering committee, and hopefully within the next few days we will finalize those results, and we'll be able to get letters out to the steering committee as well as start advertising the community meetings that we want to get as much participation as possible. The tricky part, I think, or the tough part of any particular data collecting process, as well as going forward with which projects actually make any type of bond, is I think many of you who've been on this board for some time now, you know that we have many needs in the district. And I really don't know a number yet as far as if and when we go out to the taxpayers. I don't know a number that we're going to go out for, but I can promise you that the needs are 2, 3, 4, 5 times greater than that number. So there's the trick, is to try and get as much information as possible, try to gather as much input from community as possible to get their take on it, to get their feel for it, to value what they believe we can actually go out to the taxpayers and present as a viable referendum that will be favorable to the district. So anyway, we've laid out a lot of information for you this evening. We will keep you in touch. We will bring you updates throughout the process. Feel great about it at this time. And I would say that for a board meeting, the next big board meeting is June the 15th, where we will present our findings and our recommendation. Mm-hmm. Questions for any of us? Gary, Deb, myself?
Any questions?
If I may just add, Dr. Gotardi, that this information about the planning process will be available on the district's webpage. We hope to launch a unique page in March to outline the calendar, to invite our community to participate, and to also give them a glimpse as to what is going to be covered at the meetings, an agenda outline, so that they know what to expect when they attend our meetings. And then a follow-up after a meeting to report out what was done. So just like we did with the transformation process, if you go to the transformation webpage, you can really follow a timeline of what occurred over those several months. We're planning on doing a similar process for the facility planning process, where the web would be a way to track and archive what has occurred during these next few months.
I want to add something that Gary said earlier. Deb Caldwell is a czar. She is a czar. You guys know Gary Sullivan and Jorge Cabello very well. Nobody's any more organized than Gary Sullivan and Jorge Cabello and their staff. But I can tell you that Deb is the one who has put all this together with all of our input. But she is one who's ramrodded this and helped us with all of our processes, our plans. And Gary hit it right on the head a while ago that she is the czar who is helping us formulate a plan for facility equity for the future.
Yeah.
Deb, thank you.
Thank you.
Gary, Jorge, thank you.
Thank you.
And I have to give one more kudos to Patty Cassiano, because as y'all know, and I'm talking to Letty and Sandy and Bridget, who served on our strategic design, Patty Cassiano is the czar, the transformation czar, who helped Deb with these procedures and these processes for our facility process. So kudos to all those people. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Dr. Gotardi, when was Deborah appointed to this position?
The czar?
As a director.
Deborah's been appointed, I want to say, last summer.
Summer, you named me Director of Government Relations.
So fascinating from my perspective, and maybe all of ours, is how the confluence of different talents and personalities result in this. So that's, you're commended as well. I was thinking about that when I first got on the board, she had a different position, and I think what is so interesting to me is that this whole transformation process in which parity and equity are very salient in as an objective and a goal are now manifested with what they're doing. And so now you're coming down, it's not just the brilliance of the idea, it's the execution of the idea, which I think is so hard. Mm-hmm. So I we've been hearing a lot about parity, all of us. Mm-hmm. And you're addressing it spot on. And I think needs assessment, I think about my own job, when we go out and try to get a physician to do an event, the first thing we ask is, what is your needs assessment? Because we're not just going to talk about Ebola if Ebola, there's no need. It's the same premise, and it's so important.
You know, and I have to say one more thing. We may have a few of them here in the audience, but when we gave the principals, the executive directors, and directors a month, and we did, we gave them a month to fill out the Survey Monkey. We encouraged them on the first couple of days of that Survey Monkey to go talk to their staff. Go, don't wait till the last minute.
Yeah.
go talk to your staff, go talk to your CIC, go talk to your athletic department, your fine arts department, right. your choral department, go talk to all, and I'll tell you what, the 97 participants, they really did a nice job, obviously from the examples that Gary showed. They really took it seriously and did a great job.
Another example of democracy in action. Good job. I mean it.
Thank you.
Next item.
Ten, new business for possible board action. A, resolutions. One, possible action regarding career and technical education month.
So I think this should be to Mr. Ms. Hawkins is not here, but Johnny Vahalik is. And there was lots of talk in D.C. about career and tech, and your name was mentioned more than once. Because there's a big, yes, we gave them your name.
Oh.
Cybersecurity. There's a dearth of people of laborers, and I said, "Well, you know what? I know a person."
Remember, we were the only school board represented. We were the only school board up there.
Yeah, pardon? Not the IRS, please. Not.
It was not the IRS, and they weren't looking for you.
Good afternoon, Madam President, board members, Dr. Gotardi, and executive staff and guests. It's my great honor tonight to present this resolution recognizing February as Career and Technical Education Month. Tonight, we'd like to highlight the impact CTE has on student lives and the innovation our teachers bring to the classroom. So as part of this resolution, we created a video that highlights the impact that career and technical education-based programs provide. We asked four questions. What is the best lessons you've learned from CTE classes? Did your CTE class influence what you wanted to be? And what are you most proud of learning in CTE, and what does your CTE teacher mean to you?
Hearing, oh my gosh, great teacher. She's such a sweetheart.
In both years of accounting here, and currently I'm taking a third year accounting class sometimes during my lunch period just for fun.
Miss Turner Gray, she's a lot of fun. She gets it done, she's a hardworking lady.
I go into special education, so I was especially nervous about that. But once I got into my classroom, the Ready, Set, Teach, or iPet, I knew that it was what I wanted to do and what I was meant to do.
Best thing that I've seen is probably open heart surgery. It's amazing, and it's absolutely spectacular that being a high school student, I was able to witness an open heart surgery, and definitely life-changing.
Ms. Ruiz means the world to me. She has taught me many things that I will use for the rest of my life. And I think that's the main purpose of this class, is to teach you things that not every class will teach you.
I learned how to put videos together, which was really hard in the beginning because we had to switch to Premiere and we used to do iMovie. And it was hard for me, but I'm starting to get better at it.
Used to think that coding was beyond my world, like I would never be able to do that, that was something I couldn't comprehend. And then I realized it's really an easy concept to master as long as you go about it the right way.
Last year we competed in Corpus Christi, and we went for 3 days, and we won first place, so we got to go ahead and go to nationals.
Growing up, I've been going back and forth between whether I would want to be a marine biologist or an accountant. And after taking accounting, I absolutely want to be an accountant now. And this has really helped me make my decision.
Mr. Phillips is that guy. He's personal with you, but at the same time, he's professional. He's really cool.
Probably the best singular thing for me is knowing how to read sheets and information like balance sheets and income statements, because there are adults in my life that look at those and they can't make heads or tails of them, but I can make a very clear correlation as to this is what this number means and this is a good thing or a bad thing.
One thing I've learned this year is how to be able to properly work the camera and how to focus, and then taking what I've filmed and being able to edit it to a video.
And so I went into his room not thinking I could do anything, because computer science to me was always like weird guys with the black back screen and the green text hacking into the MSA or something, and I just didn't think that was going to be possible for me. But over the years, I learned how to do computer science and harness Java, which is the language that we learn.
The best thing I've learned in culinary arts is how creative you can be in the class, because it really does teach you how to express yourself.
The best thing that I've learned this year is that we have a lot of opportunities coming into this class and to better expose ourselves in the hospital environment, and I think that's really interesting, and it's a privilege to have this sort of opportunity here in high school.
Ms. Mannheimer is a coach, she is a friend, she's an advisor, she's the one who pushes me to do things that I don't want to do sometimes.
Ms. Stroud, I mean, she's a saint.
If I had to pick one thing, I would say EMT class has really helped. In case of an emergency situation, you pretty much learn how to keep someone alive long enough to get them to the hospital and let the doctors do their jobs.
Ms. Stroud means so much to me. She has given me the opportunity to embrace my passion for medication and to also reach my goals and to become a pharmacist.
I want to study film in college, and these classes have expanded my knowledge on editing and filmmaking, and it's given me more knowledge in the subject.
I'm really proud that I've learned the history of pharmacology, actually.
I want to be a CPA when I grow up, a certified public accountant, and so the classes have been really helpful for me to see that it's not just spreadsheets and numbers, that you're actually applying the things that you learn in everyday life.
Mrs. Rohan, she's definitely like my second mother. She's always there for me emotionally, or cooking-wise. She's not just a teacher, she's a friend.
It's a lot of stuff that we're proud of, such as like how to splint people's arms and remove debris from people's eyes. It's pretty cool for me.
As myself, getting into this first period class, I did not fully understand what being a teacher was really all about. So it's really amazing to see how I've grown.
I think it's really helpful to have CTE classes in the district.
I have to thank Debbie Schaefer and Justin Misseldine. They're both program coordinators in my department, and they're not here tonight. Debbie, who did a lot of work on this, is actually with the cheerleading group in Churchill at Disney World, and they just won eighth place is what I heard. So they're fine arts is always getting my people all the time. I can't help him. To highlight the innovation in current technical education programs, I invited one of our teachers, Eric Licata, and his three students up to this presentation tonight. If they come on up. And with them here tonight are their parents. And I heard one of the parents snoring during Jeff Kerr's presentation. But they woke up during the Bond presentation, so... So I definitely appreciate their patience through all the presentations tonight. The first person I'd like to introduce here is Sean Tomset, who will be talking about his air track and electrical cars, and then Julian Weirden, who's going to be speaking about their an invention they created with a flashlight, and Sean Sweeney, who's going to speak about packaging design project they've been working on. Go ahead.
In our technology class, we have been making boxes that we can use in later life if we wanted to make make a business. Like, we made a takeout box, McDonald's French fry box with Batman and Superman, and a milk carton. And lastly, a Captain America chicken nugget box. And so also to kind of just mess around, and we've made a Skull Candy earbud set from the audio company that makes a lot of earbuds and headphones. Uh-huh. And we've put one of their earbud sets, and we've made one of their boxes to redesign the whole thing, and we also have we comp- everything is done by hand and scratch. And then, lastly, you can see this is our design for it, just written design, and now we've gotten it on the real thing, and we want to send it into the Skull Candy Company so we can see if, how they like it.
And what is your name?
Sean Thompson.
And what grade are you in?
Seventh grade.
Sean, and what's the name of your school?
Bradley Middle School.
Bradley, and who's behind you?
My teacher, Mr. Licata, and my principal, Mr. Bloomer.
Well, that's wonderful. Very impressive. Now, who's next? And what's your name?
Hello, my name is Julian Reardon, and I'm in eighth grade.
Okay.
In the CET class, we learn how to make these little electrical cars. The inside chassis, I guess, it kind of relates to the bones of a body, were individually designed on the computer and 3D printed by each individual student. And then that's basically where the engine and all that goes. And then on the body of the actual car, we like each student made like a clay mold, right? And then we vacuum formed them. So
sounds complicated.
And then we also made these little flashing lights, right? And the outer shell of it, the case, was 3D printed, and we put a little like face on it just to
Fantastic.
Add humor to it. And I guess, I don't know. And then on the inside, we actually soldered each component on a circuit board, and we learned how by changing specific components, you can change the color of the light, the speed of the blink, and the brightness.
Incredible. Wow.
Well, before I begin, I'd like to thank my teacher, Mr. Licata, for this wonderful opportunity. And I'm going to be talking about the air track that we built.
And what is your name?
I'm Sean.
And what's your grade?
Seventh grade.
Seventh grade. Okay, good.
So here you probably can't see them very well, but here at the beginning, we in the process of building the air track, we started with a simple piece of plywood and cutting it into the shape that we needed. And then we had sanded and painted and had drilled all our holes, and eventually we got to our finished product, and we got to take it to FanFest in Austin. So we had a booth in Austin. Thank you.
And it's here, right? And you guys brought the air track with you, right? I saw the air track out here, right?
Yes.
It's awesome. It's huge. It's
so
great.
Do you enjoy your class? Super exciting. So before I forget, so where is your teacher? I saw him. This is really important. I just thought of something, and it happened in Washington. We met with the U.S. Patent Secretary. He was just appointed by Barack Obama, and they hired a woman named Michelle Lee who worked for Google. They are coming. They are interested in relaxing the laws so that students can get patents for their innovations. So I invited them. Don't let me forget this. I invited them to come to Northeast, and I made them promise to me that they would only come to our school district. What they want to see, so they're planning. I'm not kidding. I have their card, and they were such incredible people. They're young. And so they're planning to come this spring. So I will contact through Dr. Gotardi. I will make the, so they can come, and this is exactly what they're looking for. So I really, you all are the future Steve Jobs and Google and everything. And so we're thrilled that you're part of Northeast.
Well, and Ms. Perkins won't say it out loud, but she is expecting to see you on Shark Tank also.
Me too.
See, now you're giving me a reason to follow up with these two gentlemen.
Absolutely.
These students also invented a little Go Public with a 3D symbol with a 3D printer. So they want to hand those out to you with magnets.
Thank you for saying that. I was about to ask if we could get the can we get the video on the website with a Go Public tag on it? I would just, oh, thank you so much. Oh, my gosh. We have a steering committee Thursday morning at 7 a.m. If y'all would like to come give it to the rest of the committee, I would love to just show this to them. I won't gloat, but yes, I will gloat.
Finish this out. I really want to give a lot of, one of the reasons I brought these three students in and Mr. Licata is about 3 years ago, Mr. Licata called me to his classroom and said, I need you to come over. I was real busy. I finally got over to him. It was during the summer and he was still working in his classroom. I don't know doing what, but he was working. And he's very dedicated. And he spent about 2 hours with me going over a 3D printer that he had purchased with his own funds through campus funds. And that was the first 3D printer that we had in a middle school that wasn't a magnet program. Mm-hmm. And so since then, we have purchased a ton of them. They run around $2,600 a printer now. And so we're buying those for all our engineering programs in high school. And back then, he was teaching career investigations, but he was so far ahead and working so far in advance and really providing what I thought was innovation in our programs in integrating technology like we've never seen before. And he has continued to do that over the last 4 years since I've known him. And I'm very appreciative of that. That experience really made me push those printers out to our district.
Right.
And it was amazing how it's taken off, and it's only going to grow in that segment and area. But he's a phenomenal teacher, and I wanted to recognize that tonight, his innovative styles and predictions. I embarrassed him. So these students and Mr. Licata represent about 150 career and technology students, 12,000 students in our programs and 130 courses. And tonight, it's my honor to request to honor our teachers for their impact and their innovation. And I'm requesting the school board to please consider approving the resolution to recognize February as CTE month.
Well, all I can say is absolutely, and it's an honor to have teachers like him in our school district, and we can't repay you enough for what you do. The students kind of take our hearts away. They're so adorable, but we cannot forget the teacher and what our teachers do for all of us. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
And we will be in touch. For sure.
Madam Chair, I'd like to make a motion to approve the resolution recognizing the month of February 2015 as Career and Technical Education Month.
Thank you, Mrs. Hewitt. Do you have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mrs. Grona. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it, and the motion carries. Next item.
B, board policy. One, possible action regarding board policy, Northeast ISD Heroes Stadium, enshrinement, criteria, and process, second and final reading.
And this is Dr. Gotardi.
Thank you, Madam President. Board members,
We brought to you last month the first reading of this brand new board policy. Today we bring you the second reading of this board policy, in which we want to begin the process of naming or enshrining heroes at Hero Stadium. Earlier today, we sent you an update to the attachment, so we hope that you're ready to move forward with approval of the second reading. If there's any questions that me or the staff can answer, we'll take them at this time. If not, we'd love for you to approve it so we can move forward. We want to begin this process, as you can see from the attachment, on March the 1st.
Right. Do we have any questions for Dr. Gottardi?
Madam Chair, I have one question.
Yes, sir.
It indicates in the second paragraph, or second or third paragraph, two individuals on the district wall of heroes. Do we mean annually, or it just says two?
Here's Mr. White, how I think we should revise this particular attachment to address that question. I think we should say the second sentence of that second paragraph should be that the district may enshrine up to two individuals on the district's wall of heroes in odd number years. Because it is our mission, Mr. White, that we don't do this every year. Okay. This is going to be a very time-consuming process. So it is our goal that up to two heroes will be enshrined at Hero Stadium every other year. Up to two. Some years there may not be any. Some years there may be one. Some years there may be two. So I guess it's my revision tonight that it would say the Wall of Heroes in odd number of years. Marie?
Right.
I don't want to.
Yeah, it is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Does this still?
I think I can make a motion that encompasses all of that.
Can we? Okay, that would really be good.
That'd be helpful.
That's where I was going.
I'm taking notes.
Yes.
I move that we approve the second and final reading of the enshrined criteria and the process as presented, along with the revisions, corrections, typos, and additions as mentioned.
Second.
Thank you, Mrs. Wolf. Thank you, Mr. White. Any additional questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. The motion carries. Thank you for catching that and for taking care of that. And Ms. Caldwell as well. Okay. Next item.
C, Campus Administration and Human Resources. One, possible action regarding approval of PDAS appraisers.
Mr. Trevino?
I can actually take
Dr.
that. President Bresnahan, members mm-hmm. of the board, Dr. Gottardi, executive staff, and guests. The Texas Education Code requires that all teachers be appraised by certified appraisers. We ask that you approve the listed administrator as a certified PDAS appraiser.
Thank you, Dr. Newman. Do we have any questions? Do I have a motion?
I move to approve as presented.
Thank you, Mrs. Perkins.
Second.
Have a second. Mrs. Grunin, thank you. Any additional questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. The motion carries. Thank you, Dr. Newman. Next item.
D, operations. One, possible action regarding SPARC program agreements between the City of San Antonio, San Antonio Sports, and NEISD.
Mr. Clary.
Madam President, members of the board, Dr. Gotardi and guests, tonight I bring to you for your approval the 2015 round of SPARC parks that we will that we would like to do at Hidden Forest and El Dorado Elementaries. We have just completed the 2014. You'll be getting an invitation to the dedication, but we've just wrapping up the SPARC parks at Cerna and Larkspur that were for 2014. So this these will be done in 2015. Just like in the last go around, the city and San Antonio Sports kick in $50,000. We kick in an additional $25,000 at each campus, asking for your approval on those tonight.
So how many total schools now?
That when we finish these, that will be, let's see, one, six? Two, three. That'll be five.
Five
in total.
That's good.
Camelot was our first.
Yeah.
And so we've done two since and have two more on the plate for this year.
Awesome. Any questions for Mr. Clary? Seeing none, do I have a motion?
I have one question.
Sure.
Will we be looking at more SPARC parks in the future, or is this?
I'm sure. Of course, it's dependent on funding from the council. Mm-hmm. So I anticipate we will, but it will just depend on if they have the funding to do so in the future.
Okay.
Great. Additional questions? Do I have a motion?
I move that we approve the SPARC program agreements with the City of San Antonio and San Antonio Sports. Further move that the Board of Trustees grant the Superintendent and Associate Superintendent for Operations authority to execute these contracts.
Thank you, Mrs. Grunow. Do you have a second? Thank you, Mrs. Wolf. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. The motion carries. Next item.
E, consent. One, business services. A, budget amendment 3. B, bid items. C, Houston interlocal agreement. Two, operations. A, Hardy Oak Elementary School walking and jogging track bid award approval. B, 2015 annual construction prevailing wage rates approval for Northeast ISD construction programs. Three, minutes from December 2014 and January 2015. Four, end of consent.
Thank you, Mrs. Huey. Is there a board member wishing to remove an item from the consent agenda? Okay. Do I have a motion to approve the consent agenda as presented?
I move that we approve the consent agenda as presented.
Thank you, Mrs. Perkins. Second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. White. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it and the motion carries. Next item.
11, reports. A, financial statement review of expenditures.
And these reports have been provided to all of us. Next item.
12, matters from the floor.
The trustees welcome comments from members of the public during this time of the meeting. Generally, board members do not respond to public comments during the meeting. Although members may request further information or a future agenda item on a matter raised during public comment. As explained fully in the board's written procedures for this time, the matters from the floor portion is a limited public forum. Accordingly, speakers may present on a topic related to district business for up to 5 minutes, but are not permitted to make one, personnel complaints about an individual staff or board member that should be raised using the district's grievance policies. Two, a personnel action. Three, a student disciplinary matter. Four, a complaint about a particular student. Five, pending litigation. Any person who persists in speaking on these topics after being directed not to do so will lose the remainder of their time to speak and may lose their privilege of addressing the board at future meetings. We also welcome written comments at any time, either through email at board@neisd.net or by mail care of the superintendent's office at 8961 Tesoro Drive, 6th floor, San Antonio, Texas, 78217.
Ready? Yes. Selena Valdez.
Thank you.
My name is Selena Valdez. I'm the Northeast Education Association president. My address is 9033 Arrow. Good evening, Madam President, members of the board, Dr. Gotardi, executive staff. Tonight, we would like to share a presentation on student discipline. May I ask the Northeast Education Association Vice President Adonis Sherman to provide each school member with a copy. Teachers are charged with delivering learning activities, corralling off-task students, spending hours creating the perfect learning environment for all students in the classroom, along with communicating feedback and assigning grades. These are just a few of the responsibilities of a teacher that affect and are affected by student behaviors. In regards to the Northeast ISD goals, student discipline greatly influenced the goal of providing a safe, supportive, and equitable learning environment for our students. In the presentation, disruptive behavior refers to any that interferes with a teacher's ability to effectively provide instruction and with other students' abilities to learn. Continued student disruptive behavior may result in up to 50% loss of instructional time and lower academic achievement for disruptive students and classmates. Teachers provided answers about the effectiveness of their campus management plans. This response is on page 12. What is shown is a lack of equity among campuses since so many have different management plans. We found the amount of plans were so many in Northeast among the 67 campuses that not all could be listed. And with so many discipline programs, how can these be monitored to show that they are enforced consistently? 75% of teachers answer that the discipline plan on their campus is inconsistent or non-effective. Through further meetings, Northeast Education Association found that many campus discipline management plans have not yet been shared with teachers, and some teachers have been informed of the discipline plan as late of our current school year as of January. Also shown is many teachers that believe their school administration does not enforce any student code of conduct, whether that is the Northeast ISD code of conduct that is approved in July, or the individual school code of conduct that's in their handbooks. In regards to teachers knowing if their campus has a discipline officer and a placement review committee, a majority answered, "I don't know." If these requirements are not on a campus, that would be a violation of Texas Education Code 37.003 and 37.009. 80% of teachers feel pressure by administration to write fewer referrals and believe over 50% of students are receiving only a verbal correction for a Northeast ISD student code of conduct levels 3 or 4 offenses. This is where the huge divide is on campuses between teachers and administration in the area of student discipline. Seldom do teachers and administration spend time together addressing the important task of developing a campus-wide discipline program. Teachers also responded that 70% of their instructional time is interrupted several times a day. One teacher's response in the presentation states that their campus plan allows for a student to interrupt 3 to 5 times in a 25-minute period. According to the 2012-13 information from TEA PEAMS data, that would be a total of $55.2 million that was spent on students with disciplinary referrals at that point in the school year. Assuming that a teacher loses only 5 to 10 minutes of instructional time, that cost could be $22.9 million or higher, and this figure does not include security monitoring, ISS personnel, administrative time to address these discipline issues. Disruptor behavior issues are not just occasional. They are daily, hourly, and everywhere. Behaviors as defiance, disruption, disrespect, pranking, failure to work, name-calling, incessant talking are left to the teacher's classroom management, and without support from an administration or fear of retaliation, which can be read from teachers' quotes provided in the presentation, teachers cannot meet the school's academic priorities in a chaotic, dangerous, or unproductive environment. The current campus management plans or campus codes of conduct is not a discipline system that fully supports the work of teachers. It supports the work of administrators. When we help Northeast students develop self-discipline through a consistent discipline system, we show them we care about their lives, not just their grades or test scores. Northeast Education Association asks the school board to adopt an effective and consistent student code of conduct that can be utilized in all campuses.
Thank you.
James McFall.
Good afternoon, school board. And
good afternoon.
Residents and everyone else. I'm a city councilman there in Windcrest, and most of some of you know me from the past. I'd run for school board about 2 or 3 years ago. But and my fortunate behavior things that happened to the grade of me being on the board of Windcrest. As an ex-educator, I've come to the conclusion after really visiting. I've visited most of our schools in our area in Windcrest, and I've been really impressed with Windcrest Elementary because the problem was is that we're losing more students to other schools, and I was in turn to find out why were these students leaving. So after asking the Windcrest Elementary to come give a presentation to the city council, they brought us up to date on a lot of things. So the things that they have been working on, is, in fact, a lot of the parents that I didn't know, a lot of the elderly people that in our community, that's been there for about 40, 50 years, since I didn't know. Then after we talked to Mr. Carney at White Middle School, that was a great presentation that everyone just was really overwhelmed with the stats and everything else that he gave. And basically asking him, well, how many students are there? Because there are pretty close to 700 students there at the Windcrest at White Middle School, at White Middle School. And we have basically about 108 students there. But out of those 108, only 68 of them are going to Windcrest Elementary that are from Windcrest. Now, my thing is this, we as a community, I've already decided and we have worked it and I've put together a committee where we're trying to bring the community more back in favor of providing to the education of our students. Because there are so many students are doing without, such as pencils, pens. We have kids coming to school hungry. Our community was so shocked to hear that 80% of our kids are on free lunch. They could hardly believe that. But this is reality. And this is reality that we all have to deal with. Times has changed. At my 28 years as a teacher, you're not only a teacher, you're a parent, you're a principal, you're everything else to this child to see that they survive. Until the board realizes that these kids are coming to school and some of the actions that they have, it's not because they want to be disruptive, because a lot of times they're dealing with things that they're dealing with at home, such as problems of not having food when they get home. Could you imagine your kid going home today and coming back tomorrow without eating from that time to this time? They're angry. You're talking about pretty close to 95% of these kids coming to school with one parent in the home, or most of them living with a grandparent. We're talking about 80% of our kids are doing without the normal that most kids are having on the upper side of Northeast School District. When in our community, we're talking about Montgomery Elementary, which they're included. In fact, they gave me a couple of notes when they found out I was coming over this way. To please, please, can we join your area because of the things that y'all are trying to do? They're on lockdown. How many times do y'all have lockdown in the district? Over there on the other side of town, it's pretty regular, according to Montgomery Elementary. We just had one over there on Mid-Crown this past week or so. And this is a common factor. We need security. Windcrest, we've encouraged our police department and Windcrest to provide as much security from our area back to these kids getting home. But when these kids leave Ed White, they're walking down into a war zone, look like. Some of the things that they have to endure, none of you would ever let your children endure these things. So as a parent, and as ex-educator, we as a group not sit back and just provide all the nice things. We got to look deeper and find out some of the professional things that we can provide. And the professional things that one of the teachers asked me to provide for he says, could you please ask for more specialized performance professionals there and to go visit these homes? Because they say sometimes the parents go up there and slide their driver's license. They want to allow them in because of their background. I can understand. We're supposed to protect our kids at every cost. But we are still, these kids, we're still trying to make this is our future. If we don't do nothing now, we're going to wind up paying for it later on. We'd rather build a prison before we build a new school. So I'm just asking you, join in and try to work together and try to provide what is necessary for our kids, because this is our future. I gave the same speech about 12 years ago when my son was...
Thank you, Mr. McFaul. Great.
Thank you.
Patsy Esterline.
Good evening, Madam President, board members, Dr. Gottardi, executive staff, and guests. My name is Patsy Esterline, and I live at 6025 Meadows Sunrise, 78244. On Monday, March the 9th, teachers and school employees from all over San Antonio are meeting in Blossom's parking lot, thanks to Dr. Gottardi, to get on 5 buses to lobby our legislators in Austin. We are taking pre-recorded stories to bring our messages to our legislators to let them know that education definitely needs more money. Lunch will be included, so please join us on the bus and help us get the message to our legislators. We hope to have 250 to 300 Bexar County educators and school employees to deliver our message to our legislators, and we would love to have you join us. Mm-hmm. So just let me know. Thanks.
Thank you.
And that's all.
Thank you. Next item.
13, board members' request for items to be placed on next month's agenda.
Do I have a board member who wishes to have an item placed on next month's agenda? Okay. Mm-hmm. Next item.
14, discussion and possible action regarding board member requests for reports from the administration.
So and we have no action, but I did neglect to do something, and I am so sorry. Mrs. Wolf, I owe you an apology. I meant to call on you when we talked about our San Antonio trip to Washington, D.C., so I'll yield to you at this point. And Mrs. Wolf was also in Washington, D.C.
Really, I'm the thing that's between us and adjournment, really?
You can make it really compelling.
Oh, I know better than that. No, I'll just I'll share a quick story with you, because Patsy, this reminded me of this just really quick. I had unrelated to our essay to DC trip, where I was able to kind of stand on the fringe a little bit, and I want to reiterate, we were the only school board that went.
Yeah, that's right.
I was there also doing a dual role with advocating for water issues, but I did have a moment the night before we left at the Hispanic Chamber Gala with Governor Greg Abbott.
Yeah.
So I shared this with Letty a little bit earlier, and if you ever get a moment with the governor, you take it. And he looked me right in the eyes. My husband kind of threw me under the bus a little bit and said, "Hey, do you know that my wife is on one of the largest school boards in Texas?" And he looked right at me and he said, "Okay, you've got a minute with the governor. What's the most important thing that school boards need today?" And I said, "Funding." And he said, or not school boards, what do schools need today? And I said, "Funding." And he said, "Okay, what kind of funding?" And I'm looking at the governor. And I said, "Well, sir," I said, "our teachers are doing great. I'm thrilled for what they have to do with what they have. But what we really need is funding for facilities and more resources for our teachers." And that was my 1 minute with the governor. So I don't know what he's going to do with it, but I'm hopeful. So at least I had a second. So that was my... And then I walked away and had to fan myself. I couldn't believe I pulled that together. But no, I'm pleased, and I definitely try to join us as we go up to Austin, because I think that's very important to show face, and I'm very happy to be in that role. So thank you for inviting us.
Thank you. Next item. Adjournment.
Sandy Wolf's adjournment. And that's 9:14.